We're going to move to a slightly different topic, and I'm going to introduce on stage Imran Haque, and he's the director of research at Council. He actually got his PhD in computer science here at Stanford, so somebody else with connection to Stanford. And then he moved on and became director of research at Council, and really what he's interested in is big data, and he's interested in novel, advanced technologies for genomic sequences, and also how to analyze and share large data sets, and how to maybe interact between these large data sets and clinical trial and clinical testing. So how do you go from this huge amount of data you have to really helping patients in the clinic? So welcome on stage, Imran. Good luck.
Thank you, Julian. And good morning, Stanford, and good morning, Internet. What I'm going to talk to you about today is what we can do, what we do, and the disconnect between the two in perinatal precision medicine. As Julian mentioned, I'm Imran Haque. I'm the director of research at Council. We're a medical genetics lab in South San Francisco. And in 2009, we were the first to introduce expanded carrier screening with the Council Family Prep Screen. Since then, we've kept our edge by upgrading generations of technology in our lab twice a year. And we're now sequencing hundreds of thousands of patient samples every year in our lab. And by the way, we're open to collaborations. Since we've started offering the Council test, we've tested over 365,000 patients by expanded carrier screening. And what I want to talk to you about today is the insights that we've gotten into rare genetic disease by doing this kind of testing. In order to set the stage, let's first examine the relative risks of different conditions that can occur during pregnancy. The 1980s really established the modern medical regime for screening and for prenatal conditions, with the first effective tests becoming available for Down syndrome, also known as trisomy 21. In 1983, ACOG, the American Congress of Obstetrics and Gynecology, established the first universal screening guideline recommending that women at high risk, basically elevated maternal age of 35 or above, all be tested for Down syndrome. This is a condition that occurs at 35.7 for every 10,000 births in that population. Also in the 1980s, the first serum screens became available to test for neural tube disorders like spina bifida, conditions that occur at about 1 in 1,000 births across the board. Now, as time and technology marched on, we were able to get more effective, cheaper, and faster screening tests, and by doing so, we were able to bring more rare conditions into the fold, starting with universal screening for trisomy 21 in all women, a condition that occurs at 1 in every 1,200 pregnancies, even for women as young as 20, and then moving on to inherited conditions, like cystic fibrosis and what Ricardo was just talking about, spinal muscular atrophy, which occur in about 4 or 1 in every 10,000 births in the Northern European population. Now, it's important to note that the particular diseases for which we test are in many ways historical and technological accident. They're the ones that were available at the time. But an expecting couple isn't so concerned about the details of trisomy 21 versus cystic fibrosis. They want to know, will my baby be healthy? So to that end, you might consider testing for a much larger panel of inherited conditions. However, when you look at these plots, you might also be reasonable to think that even if you add more conditions, they're certainly only going to be as important as CF or SMA. You know, maybe 4 people in 10,000 are going to have it. If you look at the data, you'd actually be wrong. It turns out that if you look at the 88 diseases on Council's panel, other than CF and SMA, that are at least as bad as those two diseases, they affect 27 in every 10,000 births in the Northern European population. That's a rate that's almost as high as high-risk Down syndrome, something for which we've had universal screening for over 30 years. Now, what we have to consider is whether or not this is actually going to generalize to a large number of populations. And in fact, a few months ago, ACOG and ACMG, the American College of Medical Genetics and Genomics, the other main guideline-providing agency in this area, along with a number of other groups, published a document which they titled Points to Consider About Expanded Carrier Screening. And in this, they raised two main questions. They acknowledged that while this testing can have value, they wanted to know whether or not this generalized. How important is the long tail of genetic disease? And second, how are we actually going to deliver all of these results? I'd like to use our experience testing over 250,000 patients to shed some light on these questions. First, does this result generalize beyond Northern Europe, or is this something that's really localized to one genetic population? The answer, of course, is that yes, it's a general problem. What I'm showing in this slide is a fraction of births affected by a severe or profound genetic condition on Council's panel that would have been detected by existing carrier screening guidelines promulgated by either ACOG or ACMG. What you see is that only African Americans come out looking relatively well covered here, and that's primarily because of sickle cell anemia, which has a shockingly high carrier frequency. About 1 in 10 African Americans is a carrier for this allele. Now, Ashkenazi Jews are an interesting case study. Their detection rate is 41%, which is higher than everyone else, primarily because a number of Ashkenazi-specific conditions have been added to their ethnicity-specific panel. However, when you look at every other group, you see that the detection rate is shockingly low, from 1 in 4 in Southern Europe to 1 in 20 in the Middle East. What this means is that current screening guidelines are really missing between 75% and 95% of births that we could detect today with current technology. And these are diseases that really matter. Jen and Joe Baumgartel were a couple who had no previous family history of genetic disease. But when they took the Council test, they learned that they were both carriers for Smith-Lemli-Opitz syndrome, a profound disorder that can cause miscarriage and that, if the child is born, can cause physical or intellectual disability. They were able to take this information and do something positive with it. Using IVF-PGD, they were able to conceive a healthy baby daughter, Kinley. So this is half the story. We know that there's quite a lot of so-called rare genetic disease out there, we know how to detect it, and we know that it's actually important. The second part of the question is, how do we actually counsel and deliver these results to patients and providers? The traditional solution is to deliver the results in the context of a doctor's appointment or a genetic consultation session. The problem with that is the scaling that was talked about in the plenary this morning. Basically, the pace of genetic testing is scaling exponentially as the cost of sequencing has fallen. The problem is that the number of certified genetic counselors in the United States has only grown by about 5% per year for the last 5 years. This disconnect means that at a large number of institutions, patients have to wait multiple weeks in order to get the results delivered to them by a genetic counselor. In an era where you can get the sequencing done in just a couple of days, it really doesn't make any sense to make patients then wait another 2 weeks to get the results delivered. So what do? Our solution was to completely re-engineer the process of laboratory resulting. The very first step was to move results to the web. After creating an account on our website, patients are able to track their sample in real time as it makes its way through the lab, and then when the result is done, to log on their phone or their computer and see the results right there. But that's not enough. If you were to just deliver a traditional laboratory test result over the computer, it wouldn't help anyone because it would be incredibly confusing. So we fully re-engineered and redesigned the lab report itself. If you were a carrier of CGG type 1A and you logged into the website to see the results, you would see something like this. Right up top is a summary of the one result that you actually care about. Instead of seeing a long laundry list of conditions, you see the important stuff right up top. And then when you scroll right below, you actually see a series of videos recorded by our genetic counselors that are tailored to exactly your result scenario, that explain what you have and explain next steps. Now, by putting resulting before a counseling session, we're enabling what we call genetic counseling triage. Basically, the notion that a lot of patients, if their information is delivered to them in a well-designed and well-thought-out way, might not need a full counseling session. That said, everyone who gets a counsel test is entitled to get a full genetic consultation session. And in fact, in 2014, we did 11,000 genetic consultations, enough to put us in the company of institutions like UPMC and the Mayo Clinic. Now, while at other institutions, patients might have to wait a couple of weeks to speak to a counselor, half of our patients were able to get consultations through counsel within just a few days. That doesn't sound very good until you consider that the other half were able to get their consultations within minutes. Last year, 46% of our consults were done using what we call on-demand genetic counseling. Patients who were getting the results delivered online could click a button and within just a few minutes be speaking on the phone to one of our genetic counselors. Let's look at the data to see what this translates to in practice. What I'm showing here is both the fraction of couples who had different result types who needed counseling on the bottom, and then on the y-axis, looking at how long those consultation sessions took. Now, there's a bit of systematic bias in the numbers at the bottom, because some clinics choose to counsel results themselves rather than letting our GCs handle it. But the trend is clear. When the result is well designed and well delivered, there are a large number of couples, particularly those receiving negative or no disease detected results, who don't need to speak to a genetic counselor. They've gotten the information they need through self-service. The other interesting thing is when you look at the graph itself, look near the top at the dashed line at 30. That shows a half hour, the quantum of time in which typical genetic consultations are reserved. The reason for that is because in a typical hospital setting, genetic counselors have an awful lot of paperwork that they have to fill out associated with a consult. We use technology to shift this busy work onto computers and away from our genetic counselors, meaning that once they spend the time with the patients, they don't have to spend another 20 minutes on paperwork. They can use that to speak to the next patient, making the best use of a scarce resource, a counselor's time. So let's recap. What I wanted to show to you today was a disconnect between what we can do and what we do. I showed you that even though we have the capability to test for hundreds of genetic conditions, current guidelines are missing between 75 and 95% of affected births in preconception and prenatal testing. And even though we have the technology to have patients speaking to counselors within minutes of getting their results, in many cases, we're currently making them wait weeks to speak to a counselor. The upshot is that in many cases, it's not going to take magic or science fiction to deliver precision medicine. Simply by implementing technologies that we know now, we can actually bring this into the clinic today. Thank you.